enough. We have to talk about these women who are vulnerable, who don't feel empowered to use their voices. They don't have the platform, sometimes the courage, or certainly the means to say enough. They have been used and tossed out like trash by billionaires, music stars, powerful men who have been accused of horrendous things. And too often, these seemingly invisible women get overlooked. Let me give you the last three examples. In the case of R. Kelly, the charges against him date back decades, showing a pattern, years of alleged sexual abuse. So why now?
We've been asking for decades to pay attention to the stories of these black girls.
Why do you think it took so long?
Because they were black.
Kelly has been accused of cruising Chicago fast food joints, his old high school, preying upon star-struck teenagers. And sometimes Kelly would wait in his car while someone on his team would allegedly approach these girls, getting their numbers. Enough. In the case of Robert Kraft, the billionaire Patriots owner, get past the tabloid headlines and the charges against him of soliciting prostitution, first-degree misdemeanors, and you will see women allegedly being trafficked around the world, around a state, living in despicable conditions, forced into hell, hell in plain sight.
They were averaging 8 clients a day, and if you do the math, that's approximately 1,500 men a year with no days off. It was clear that multiple women were working and living inside the spas. They were cooking on the back steps of the business. They were sleeping in the massage parlor on the massage tables. They had no access to transportation.
As Sheriff Snyder told the New York Times, it was really a rescue operation. He said the monsters are the men. Enough. And one of the president's cabinet members, former U.S. Attorney Alex Acosta, served as the federal prosecutor in charge when a billionaire got a sweetheart of a deal. The Department of Justice found to have broken the law in the case of Jeffrey Epstein, who was accused but not convicted of being a serial sex abuser of underage girls. And these girls, according to all this reporting out of the Miami Herald, included some of the most vulnerable, a foster child who he promised new shoes for school, or a runaway lured to be a part-time masseuse. These are girls he paid to bring him more girls, according to the Herald. His punishment, a plea deal, which meant Jeffrey Epstein only got 13 months in prison on lesser prostitution charges, during which he could leave for work and no federal trial. Just think about that. A federal investigation identified at least 36 underage victims. 36. Enough. As Roxanne Jones wrote in a CNN piece, the common thread, she says, the systematic exploitation of young girls and women who often are poor, vulnerable, ignored, and silenced. And I will say, in the past 2 years, our collective conscience has been awakened to this as a result of allegations against Hollywood's biggest names, or NFL owners, or Grammy Award-winning musicians. We should note R. Kelly and Robert Kraft have denied these allegations they're facing, but let me be clear. This story is bigger than these men. Much bigger. We should be focused on empowering and protecting the women they're accused of victimizing. Let this be a time of reckoning. These seemingly invisible women need to know your voice has a power no amount of money or power or fame can buy. Enough is enough. Martin County Sheriff William Snyder, you just heard me quote him, is with me now. He was the one who announced this sting in Florida just last week that includes those solicitation charges against Bob Kraft. Moments ago, the state's attorney for Palm Beach County said that there are no charges of human trafficking yet. But Sheriff, you tell me, that could change as the investigation proceeds?
Well, yes, Brooke, good afternoon. It could absolutely change. As a matter of fact, just before I came on air with you, I was watching an interview with one of our victims, one of the women who had been trafficked, and I was listening firsthand to her story. And our goal with her is to get her to cooperate, give us the probable cause we need to add to the existing charges, and that would be a charge of trafficking.
It's interesting hearing how you say try to get her to talk. You know, I was reading that there were a lot of Mandarin translators were brought in, and a lot of these women. Is it a trust issue? Why is it so difficult for them to speak their truth?
You know what I try to do? I try to put myself in their position and try to understand what the rationale is and why they are oftentimes reluctant to cooperate. And what we're trying to understand in our cases is what was the coercion point? What is it that caused these women to go and allow themselves to be trafficked to work long hours from 9 a.m. till 11 p.m, no days off, eating off of hot plates? They had the ability. They could have walked out into the street and asked for help, but they didn't. And in our case that we're working now, she is maintaining that she was afraid that her family in China would be at risk if she cooperated.
Which explains why you called this a rescue operation. Sheriff, you're a former state legislator who wrote the first human trafficking bill in the state of Florida, so you have a lot of history on this very issue. Will you just tell me, why has this been so important for you?
In my whole life, in my career in law enforcement, one of the things that I've always detested was the bully. And although we're tasked with investigating crimes where there may not be bullying, whenever there's a power imbalance, and I think your former guest was talking about it, I feel like it's my job, it's my responsibility to try to step in and stop the bullying. And in this case, this is really the ultimate bullying. You have a woman who probably comes from a province in China where maybe education isn't the biggest thing in her life. And she finds herself lured here to the United States. In our case, she testified to the promise of working in a nail salon and then finds herself trafficked. So your question to me, why is it so important to me? It's because if I don't give them a voice, they have no voice.
Thank you for the work you do, Sheriff Snyder. Thank you so much.
Very welcome.